AF supports creating templates that you can then use to create elements that are based on that template. And so let's take a look at some existing templates. I'm going to go ahead and leave the database we've been working on lately, go over to this training sample that we use a lot in training. And if you look through this training sample, if you were to do a search, a quick one of our advanced searches through this, you'll notice one of the things that you can search for is you can search for things by the template that they're based on. So for example, if I look for chemical tank, I can find that there are a large number of chemical tank based elements here. These are all based on the template called chemical tank. And that's because at some point I sat down and I defined, well, what is it that I would need in a chemical tank? What attributes would I need? A lever level, a temperature, maybe strapping table calculations. All those types of things I built into the template, and then when I needed to build the elements, I built the elements from that template. Same for this flow meter or heat exchanger. If I go out and search for all the heat exchangers, there are a lot of different heat exchangers in my entire database here, and they're all based on that one heat exchanger type. So, and I can drill down through here and find them this way as well. Well, anyway, the point of this section is to discuss these templates. Why would you want to build a template? And, you know, if you're a developer, if you're a C-sharp guy, or you've worked with a lot of object-oriented programming languages, the concept of templates is a no-brainer. I mean, it's defining a class, and from once you have a class defined, you instantiate objects of that class, et cetera, et cetera. But to be honest, if you're not a developer, it's not really that obvious what we mean by a template. I like the analogy that Microsoft uses. Microsoft says, "Hey, you know, if you haven't been programming for the last 10 years, this might be a brand new topic. But here's something you may be familiar with. You're familiar with cookie cutters. You know, I'm going to go out and want to make a bunch of cookies that are shaped like apples. No problem. I just create a cookie cutter that's shaped like an apple, and then I just go ahead and stamp or instantiate" a cookie from that cookie cutter. I go ahead and stamp this 6 times. I have 6 cookies that are shaped like apples. Same for this mix tank here that's suspiciously shaped like a deer. Anyway, these different templates, or, you know, that's what they are basically. A cookie cutter is a template, is used to create objects of the same type. And of course, it has all the same attributes. For example, this mix tank has a nose, 2 little ears, and a little furry tail. So any element you create from that template will have those same specific attributes. All of these things have specific attributes. This has 4 leaves. You know, this has little leaves at the top. This has wheels at the bottom. Those are the attributes of that template. And that's what we do with AF. You create a template. That template has specific attributes, and then as you stamp these events or these elements out of these templates, you create elements that have all the same attributes. So let's take a look at where this is done. It's actually done in the library section. So if we take a look at our collection of templates, we'll see among them is the element templates collection, and from there I can find this chemical tank. And as you can see, the chemical tank has a variety of different attributes, all the different attributes that you would associate with a chemical tank. It's got an inside temperature, level, outside temp, product, etc. So every single element I build based off of this element template is going to have all these things. Now, when you're creating templates, there are issues as to, you know, what do you predefine in advance so that every single element that's created from that template has those attributes, and what do you leave to define later when you actually create the element, when you stamp the element out of the element template. And we'll discuss that as we get into, you know, making those choices. Now, one of the first questions you'd ask yourself is, do I really need an AF system that's got templates? Can I just create elements one at a time? It's a good question, and if you are not creating elements that are similar in any way, if you never have a situation in which you're going to build more than one element that looks pretty much the same as another element, then you probably don't need element templates. Now, if you take a look at this Houston area here, I look at our tanks. We've got 2 tanks established in Houston, And then in addition, whoever is setting up AF here, he's also got Montreal and San Leandro, and these different places also have tanks. Now, in this case, he's definitely going to, at some point, need to define what a tank looks like. And as you can see, in this case, the tanks that are defined consistently with these elements, they have the same attributes in Montreal versus San Leandro versus Houston. They're all built off of the same element template. So if you don't have a situation like that, then you might be able to get away without using element templates. But it's going to save you some time if you do have more than one element that you would base on that template. It's going to save you time to create a template. The other big advantage of this, of course, is that you've got consistent definition from one element to the other. So if they're all based on an element template, you know, whether you're in Montreal, whether you're in Houston, or San Leandro, you're always going to have the same attributes. Now, I'm going to tell you a brief aside here. We've seen over the years how systems, as they grow, if they don't have some kind of a templatizing methodology, if they're not using element templates or doing some procedure to try to make uniform representations of their equipment, then what you end up finding is, you know, some areas, well, they define a tank one way, and within that definition, they've got some nice little calculations that they use a great deal. They build these reports off these calculations, and hey, great, you know, great for the Houston guys. They've got this wonderful representation. You know, the guys up in Montreal, however, they may have a different set of attributes, and they may not have all the calculations. Their reports don't look the same as the guys in Houston. And if they ever try to take the guys the Houston reports and say, hey, that looks good, let's use those. First thing they find out is there's a lot of things in the definitions in Houston that they don't have in Montreal, so they can't really use that same report format. So, you know, the attempt to be consistent throughout your organization is really what drives the concept of using templates. So, you know, it's not just an extra feature, you know, looking for somebody willing to use it. It's actually a problem that will crop up in a system over time, and this is the solution to that problem. You base things on templates so that as time goes on, you can be consistent. And of course, one of the beautiful things about these templates is if I decide after 2 years of working with this that we need to extend this template so that it's got more attributes, well, that's no problem. Just change the element template and all the elements that are built on that element template will get those updates. So if you add 3 new attributes to the template, you'll find those 3 new attributes in Houston, in Montreal, and in San Leandro. They'll show up in all of these, you know, all of these different tanks that have been built for years based on that template. And let me return back to our library to take a look at these element templates again. Yeah, these element templates, they can be something that's as specific as a template for a specific tank from a manufacturer or a reactor from a specific manufacturer, or it could be something that's more generic in nature. So there's no hard and fast rule of thumb as to, you know, what the scope of your template is. It could be something generic, it could be something specific. It's whatever helps you to scale up and do it consistently. So we're going to create these templates in this library option. So down here in the Navigator pane, we've been mostly working with elements. Now we're going to shift. We're going to take a look at library and start working with templates. I'll switch back over to the database that we've been working with so far. That was the one called OSIsoft Plant. You'll notice that in the Navigator pane, if we look at that Navigator pane, then go up to the Browser pane, we can see this is where we've been working so far. We're going to make a switch. We're going to now go through the Navigator pane. We're going to choose Library. In the browser, we'll see that there are no element templates that have been defined. So how do you create element templates? Well, as you might guess, you select the collection, do a right-click, and choose New Template. I believe you can also do it from here, yeah, as well. I'll go ahead and choose New Template, and this is where you would define that element template. Now let me go ahead and cancel out of that. I'll do a right-click. I'll do New Template. And here's my template. I'll go into General and specify the name of the template. So if this is going to, I'm just going to call this My Tank. And I'll press Return. I can check this in. And what I've accomplished here is next to nothing, because I've got a template that has no attributes. I mean, it's like a cookie cutter that's just round. I mean, great, it'll stamp a cookie, but there's nothing unique about it, nothing that distinguishes that from anything else. So this element template's kind of useless. The next thing to do is to add these attribute templates. And it's roughly analogous to an element has attributes. Well, an element template has attribute templates, and we'll get to those next. One last point that really ought to be made, especially for those of you who look at this and say, hey, hold on a second, what about that work we just did with the elements? Do we have no way of taking advantage of that? Well, actually, there's some good news in that regard. If you go out to the elements that are already defined, like this wonderful mixing tank that we already defined, it's got all these nice attributes, it's got calculations, it's got references to Pi tags, etc. Well, what I can do with a right click here, there's an option here to say, let's convert this to a template. I can use this as a way to convert or create an element template based on that element that already exists. I'll go ahead and check that in. If I go down to the library, there we go. Here's our mixing tank template. As you can see, it's got all of the attributes that we had before. Now, the one problem that we have with this is these have hard-coded references in them. So right now, you know, everything's got specific default values. These different references, the Pi point references, they're pointing to specific Pi tags. And of course, you don't necessarily want that when you're creating new elements from a template. You may want those to be either left undefined or left blank, or using some algorithm to specify a Pi tag name based on the name of the element or the name of the server and the element together, which is all the things that we're going to discuss later on. So there's some conventions that you can use with these element templates to more or less avoid the hard-coded tag names like what you see right here. But the point I wanted to make is, as you can see, it's very, very simple to exploit the earlier work that you've done by just doing a right click and converting that existing element to an element template.